When a company decides to implement a business intelligence platform, there are choices that have to be made about the type of platform that'll be built and the specific tools and technologies that'll be used to convert raw data into useful information. While decisions like these usually fall into the realm of IT, line of business staff need to actively participate in these decisions to make sure the BI platform will support their analysis needs. The process that BI platforms use to capture raw data and convert it into useful information may be simple or very complicated. A common BI platform that many organizations use to support their BI initiatives is the data warehouse system. The data warehouse system is made up of several pieces that work together to supply data to decision makers. It's generally a good idea to start off with a high-level view of the system and then drill down into the details. Data comes from the operational systems that support the day-to-day transactions of the business. A company or business unit of a large corporation may have dozens of operational systems. These systems can be line-of-business applications like human resource systems, supply chain systems, enterprise resource planning applications, or customer resource management systems. These operational systems are extremely efficient at supporting transactional processes, but they're not very good at supporting business analysis, especially when the analysis requires compiling data from multiple data sources. Knowing these limitations of operational systems, many companies meet their business reporting and analysis needs by gathering data from their operational systems and storing that data in a giant collective repository. This repository has a name you're already familiar with, the data warehouse. When we say that a data warehouse is a collective repository of data, we didn't necessarily mean that it's a single data store. These days, most enterprise data architects define the data warehouse as a centralized store that feeds into a series of subject-specific stores called data marts. Others go even further and define the data warehouse as a collection of data marts. The common denominator in both definitions is the concept of a subject-specific data mart. While data marts are subject-specific, the definition of a subject varies from company to company depending on the type of analysis that needs to be performed. For example, a company might build a data mart to support the sales department's need to analyze product sales performance and profit margins. The same company might have another data mart that lets the HR department analyze trends in headcount and the average number of sick days for each employee. Whatever data warehouse definition you decide to adopt, it's important to understand that the data warehouse shouldn't just be a collection of independent silos of data. If it contains independent silos, it doesn't provide you with any benefit over the operational systems. In a true data warehouse, common dimensions and measures should be able to be easily shared. This sharing is important not only to make sure measures and dimensions have common meanings across the company, but also to support the calculation of metrics that combine data from different operational systems. For example, a metric like revenue per employee is difficult to calculate with operational systems because you need data from the sales system silo and data from the human resources system silo. In a data mart, it's easy to calculate this metric by combining sales data from the sales data mart and employee data from the human resources data mart based on shared dimensions such as time and employee. The more data that can be shared across business processes, the more powerful your analysis can be. As you've probably guessed by this point, integrating all of this data isn't quite as easy as I've been making it sound. It involves a lot of work, especially when you have mountains of data that come from multiple operational systems. There's a special set of processes, collectively known as ETL processes, whose purpose is to extract, transform, and load data from one or many operational systems into the data warehouse. Although business people typically don't have much direct exposure to the details of the ETL processes, they do participate in defining the business rules that drive how data is integrated. The business rules are usually determined based on the type of analysis that's going to be performed and how well the data supports those analysis requirements. Once it's loaded into the data warehouse, business reporting and analysis processes are responsible for taking data from the data warehouse, assembling it into a business-friendly format like spreadsheets, charts, and graphs, and delivering this information to business users. The software packages that implement this process are loosely called front-end tools. These front-end tools harvest information from the data warehouse and present it to users in the form of reports and interactive views. Data can also be investigated using more advanced analysis technology, such as data mining, to find data patterns that explain behavior or uncover trends that are hard to see with the naked eye. While the specifics of these processes depend on the needs of the business users, their overriding goal is to put useful data into the hands of decision makers to help them make better decisions faster. Now that we've taken the 30,000-foot view of how data flows from operational systems to business users through a data warehouse, it's time to take a closer look. Let's start with the part business users care about the most, the reporting and analysis processes. Of all the components of the data warehouse architecture, reporting and analysis is probably the one that business users are most familiar with, because its primary purpose is to put data in their hands. For this to have any benefit to business users, reporting and analysis processes need to assemble data into a format that's meaningful to different types of business staff. Making data understandable and useful to business users is one of the primary motivations behind multidimensional analysis. Although tabular grids are a great way to consolidate data, it's also important for business users to see data displayed graphically using charts and other visualization techniques. Often, these graphics work hand in hand with tables to give users different perspectives on the data. To get a sense of the power even simple graphics can provide, let's look at a classic, but obviously made up, example. Let's say you have four departments, each with 11 employees, and you want to analyze the impact tenure has on the number of days people are out sick each year. Here's a table with the data for the four departments. The average tenure for each department is 9 years, and the average number of sick days for each is 7.5. Most people could stare at these four tables for hours and not gain much insight. But most people who examine the graphical representations of the same data see very obvious differences and patterns, which aren't nearly so obvious in the tables. When presented in an appropriate graphical format, information and insights practically jump off the screen. If you're doing analysis work, you need to think about the best strategy for presenting data to business users, whether it's tables, charts, or graphs. Up to now, I've been referring to business users as one generic group of people. But from a reporting and analysis perspective, business users usually fall into one of three distinct user communities, depending on their specific analysis needs: the information user, the information consumer, and the power analyst. At the bottom of the user pyramid are information users, often the largest part of a business community. The information user generally requires standard reports, which may be brief or extended, and often include charts as well as tables. The information user wants to scan consistently structured reports without needing to slice and dice to find the desired values. This typically involves creating static or very simple interactive reports, either in printed form or as standard Microsoft Office documents. The information consumer is the next step up the pyramid. They require the ability to dynamically query the database without becoming an expert at database design or the query tool. The information user typically wants a guided user experience that allows pivoting and nesting when desired, while eliminating options that may create undesirable results. If there's an interactive solution available that provides ad hoc multidimensional analysis, many business people end up crossing a line between information users and information consumers. At the top of the pyramid are the power analysts, who require the full analytical power of the data mart so they can perform free-form ad hoc analysis. The power analyst is willing to learn the details of database design and the query tool in order to obtain the necessary results. The power analyst often creates reports that will be used by others. As you'd expect, of the three groups, this one has the fewest members. Front-end tools implement the reporting and analysis process by harvesting data from the data warehouse and presenting it to business users in a form of reports and interactive views. The front-end tools that support business reporting and analysis can be roughly grouped into two primary categories. The first group is made up of tools that follow a reporting paradigm. These tools tend to excel at producing tabular reports. Many of these tools are considered mature these days and provide web interfaces for designing and viewing reports suitable for very wide-scale deployments. They also tend to have strong printing and scheduling capabilities. The second group is made up of tools that follow the multidimensional ad hoc data exploration paradigm. These tools tend to excel at reading OLAP cubes, supporting interactive analysis, and providing graphical views. As you'd expect, there's a lot of competition among vendors in this space. There's a wide range of functionality and features, along with the usual wild claims from some vendors that their tool is the only one you'll ever need, the one that will bring balance to the force. If someone ever says that to you, just remember what happened with the last product that was supposed to bring balance to the force. Also keep in mind that features aren't the same as benefits. Product features that provide advanced capabilities for ad hoc analysis may provide a lot of benefit to power analysts who spend a lot of time exploring the data, but they're probably not worth much to information users who need strong reporting and distribution capabilities. If you're designing a BI system, you need to invest some time figuring out your broader BI objectives and the specific needs of your users. Then, sort out product offerings based on those objectives and needs. So let's take a look at how a data warehouse can help fulfill a business's analysis needs. Because the primary job of a data warehouse is to support reporting and analysis, the requirements of the business drive its content and design. In practice, this means that business users define the information that will help them make better decisions faster, so the IT professionals can build a data warehouse to meet their needs. This works best when business users and IT specialists share a common understanding of what a company's business requirements are and how a data warehouse fulfills these requirements. To get a baseline understanding of what a data warehouse offers a company, let's explore some of its common characteristics. Like we talked about a little earlier, a data warehouse organizes data into subject-specific areas called data marts. These data marts aren't individual silos of data like the operational source systems. Instead, data marts add value by being able to gather data from lots of operational systems to support a specific line of analysis, such as a sales data mart that supports product line profitability. To present a cohesive source of data to decision makers within an organization, data in the data warehouse is shared among the data marts. A data warehouse provides users with a consistent set of data by using the same dimensions and measures everywhere. Consistent means that the data reported and analyzed has the same definitions across the data warehouse and across the company at large. Achieving consistent data in a data warehouse requires a company to consider both integration decisions and organizational decisions. When source data comes from multiple operational systems, it's necessary to decide how you'll integrate the data into one common view for analysis and reporting. For example, when you need to analyze the effects of discounts on profit margin, you might discover that each of your company's source systems assigns a slightly different meaning to the word discount. A data warehouse gives you the opportunity to integrate this disparate data based on a uniform understanding of how you want to report and analyze discounts. Another example is when source systems have slightly different dimensional data, such as organizational structures, product hierarchies, or geographical roll-ups. The data warehouse can also mitigate these differences in dimensional structures by defining uniform dimension designs. Storing consistent data also requires you to make some organizational decisions about how you assign standardized meanings to measures and dimensions between departments. For example, a sales department may need to decide how the sales revenue metric is calculated. Does sales revenue include only the direct sales of the company's sales reps, or does it also include indirect sales, such as orders placed over the internet? The company is definitely going to be interested in both types of sales revenue. The key is making sure each type is clearly identified and universally agreed upon. Making sure that people in a company speak the same language, in terms of dimensions and measures, is critical if you want consistent reports to be generated across the organization. When business users analyze data from a data warehouse, they want cleansed data. That's data that's been validated according to business and structural rules. The good news is that storing cleansed data is one of the data warehouse's most important priorities and business benefits. The bad news is that the source data from operational systems usually doesn't start out in a cleansed state. Far from it. This uncleansed data is called dirty data. Dirty data can be data that's missing. For example, the person who entered a cancellation order into the order entry system didn't enter a reason why the customer canceled the order. Dirty data is sometimes flat-out incorrect data, like a single Walmart store reporting that it sold 50,000 razor blades in a one-hour period. Data entry areas, like Boston, MA, instead of Boston, MA, also show up with distressing frequency. Dirty data can also be more subtle, like sales of a particular product being counted twice because of an error in a point-of-sale system. To cleanse dirty data from the operational systems for storage in the data warehouse, ETL processes are used to load valid data and reject invalid data based on a company's business rules. Being able to analyze data over specific periods of time is a powerful benefit of the data warehouse. Unlike operational systems, which focus on managing the day-to-day transactions of the business, a data warehouse is interested in providing users with snapshots of data from the operational systems. These snapshots typically don't change from minute to minute like the operational systems. Instead, the data warehouse is refreshed with new snapshots of data in periodic intervals, such as hours, days, weeks, or even months. It's because of this the data warehouses are considered to be non-volatile, that is, pretty much non-changing. By storing these snapshots over time, business users can analyze and identify historical trends and exceptions in the data. For example, business users can compare their product sales from a quarter of the current year against the same quarter last year and the year before. To support high-speed analysis work, a data warehouse has to provide its data to business users in a timely and efficient manner. This means that the database technologies and the behind-the-scenes data structures need to support fast and efficient delivery of the data. Within most data warehouse architectures, there are two types of databases that are used to host data marts: Olap databases and relational databases. The benefits of an Olap database are its native support of the multidimensional paradigm and its fast data retrieval capabilities. Olap databases are efficient in handling hundreds of millions of data combinations because they pre-process as much as possible. They also save aggregated values and structures that are optimized for fast data retrieval. These features make Olap databases great candidates for hosting data marts. Although Olap database technology has been around for years, there have been two important recent developments. It's gotten significantly easier to design Olap databases, and the cost of acquiring enterprise-grade solutions has fallen through the basement. The net effect of these two developments is that we're entering a new era of Olap for the masses, the technology that was once only available to a few people in the largest mega-national corporations is now available to all information consumers, even in the smallest companies. Given all of these benefits of Olap databases, especially performance, you might be wondering what role traditional relational databases play in data warehouse architecture. Within the data warehouse itself, a relational database is often used in conjunction with Olap databases to host data marts, in some cases supplying data to the Olap databases. In this scenario, the relational database typically stores more detailed data than the Olap database, which contains a summarized view of the data. For example, to support sales analysis, a sales data mart may contain a relational component to host the detailed daily sales data. It may also contain an Olap component to store summarized sales data by customer, product, month, and region. Relational databases can also host data marts in an independent role, without Olap databases, by having their own set of dimensions and measures to support business reporting and analysis. Usually this approach depends on sophisticated front-end tools. They assemble the relational data into a business-friendly format and provide the data to business users in a timely manner. The data warehouse architecture offers a flexible and effective decision support framework for organizing and delivering data to decision makers. It brings business intelligence to life through its usage of data marts, database technologies, ETL tools, and reporting and analysis tools. In a data warehouse, all of these components work together to help the business make better decisions faster.